Nice to be here. My name is Nili. I work for the Israeli government for, when I say 20 years, I want to drop dead, but 20 years almost, and work for the Ministry of Industry and Trade in Israel. The Ministry of Industry and Trade, today it's also the Ministry of Industry, Trade and Labor, is the probably the most influential economic office that for the Israeli industry. And we'll talk a little bit about it, and I understand that you have the background of it about Israel and that you've read parts of Startup Nation, so some of it will sound familiar to you, but I wanted to draw the broader picture of what was basically the government's role and in creating this Startup Nation. And I think that here, you know, usually governments are not portrayed in a very positive and proactive way. For me as a government employee, you know, I don't want to give grades to the government, but some of the programs that the government initiated were probably very entrepreneurial, flexible, started on time, and probably the most important thing, ended on time. So, and from this point of view, I think that the government interacted well with the needs of the Israeli industry. So this is move forward. So I don't know, maybe you've seen already this slide, but this is the International Competitive Report, and Israel is ranked quite the good position in R&D and innovation. And basically what I wanted to talk about is the areas where the government had a little bit of influence. And this is of course the R&D expenditure, and as a percentage of the GDP, the creating the entrepreneurial spirit or building managerial skills, which we have a long way to go. You've heard the previous speaker, we are maybe good startup companies, we need to know how to manage bigger companies, and there is a lot of thing done here, and I'll show it later, and also creating basically the venture capital industry, which is probably one of the most, if I'm talking about the startup company, the government gives money, and you need the private sector to be part of the triangle, and the government also was played a very significant role in creating this industry. So again, this slide I hope you've seen before, but this is the percentage of the R&D investment in Israel as a percentage of the GDP. 30% of that is government funding, and 70% is private sector funding, which means that the government funding leverages the private sector's money, and it leverages quite well. And so basically the main organization in Israel that is responsible for nourishing and sponsoring and giving grants to R&D companies is the Office of the Chief Scientist. And I do hope that you're going to meet Bird, which is part of it, and you're going to meet Ed Milavsky, I understand, and others. The Office of the Chief Scientist is probably the most important factor from the government perspective that works with the high-tech industry. And today it's 300 or $400 million that are granted each year to the industry, to the high-tech industry. They are granted to companies that develop new technologies or new processes. It's 30 to 50% of their total R&D plan is being financed by the government. It's on a competitive basis, so companies apply to grants, and there is a selection committee, and professional people are examining their program, and the government gives the grant, and and it services startup companies as well as big companies, and only if the company succeeds, so only if the product has been developed and sold outside of and being sold, then the company pays back the government royalties, 3% a year from the sales up to 100% of the grant. If the project failed, then the government basically shared the risk and is not getting anything back. OCS, which is the initials of the Office of the Chief Scientist, today the numbers are, grants approximately 2,000 projects a year. The requested budget is 6.5 million new Israeli shekels divided by four, approximately. So the total grants is 1.6, approximately $400 million. So this is the fuel, the ongoing fuel for the Israeli high-tech industry. And the Office of the Chief Scientist started its work, started to be active since the 80s, I think 84. Started to grant companies. There was another program which you read in Startup Nation, the Bird Foundation, which started even earlier in 97, and it's a joint R&D fund between the government of Israel and the government of the US, $110 million endowment, and from the royalty, from the interest and royalties that companies pay back, this program finances mutual R&D activities. Now, what was the concept behind it? That we have small Israeli startups in Israel, we have huge American corporates in the US, and matching the two together will make sense for both sides. We'll have a pipeline of new technologies for the US corporates, and we have their marketing and marketing capabilities, as well as being situated in the biggest market for Israeli companies. So this fund was very, it wasn't so good at the beginning, and I think when Ed took over, it started to grow up dramatically and fund a lot of projects, and this fund was the other tool that was active in the beginning. Bird today, the performance, it granted $290 million, 825 projects were approved, the repayments were $91 million, and the sales were $8 billion. And, okay, now what happened to the industry? So till now we had the OCS, the R&D grants, and we had Bird, and the Israeli exports looked basically like this. In 1992, oranges exports, which was the most famous export of Israel, was, I don't know, $100 million, as well as IT exports. This was in 1992. So something happened here that changed dramatically what was happening in Israel and dramatically the high-tech scene. So here were two main programs that the government initiated that had dramatic impact on the industry. The Yozma program, which you also read, and the incubator, it's also in Startup Nation, everything is there. So basically we had startup companies that received some money from the government, but it wasn't enough. So the government said we need to attract private money into this game as well. And we don't have, as in the US, we don't have venture capital, we don't have money from private people to invest in these companies. So the government came up with this brilliant program that started on time and finished on time. And the program was basically to allocate $100 million to do a competitive bid, an RFI, or basically, and to say the government is willing to put $8 million to every fund that will bring to the table $12 million. Not only that, we'll give you also all the upside. So if the fund will be successful, you can buy out the government without, only with paying the $8 million plus interest. So you don't pay back the upside from the companies and the portfolio itself. This was a huge success, and we had 10 VCs. Basically, they invested, because of the competitive process, they were able to increase the amount of money that they raised. So for every $8 million, they received $16 million and not 12. $20 million out of the $100 million was a fund that was managed by the government, and this basically created the VC community in Israel. And the nice thing is that after 5 years, this industry was up and running, invested in a lot of companies, and the government said, okay, our role here is finished, and all of the 10 VCs bought the government out. So the government was no longer had equity in these VCs. So the VC industry, you see the capital that it raised through the years, started with 10 funds, $200 million they raised, and today, I think today we have a bit less. It's over 200 VCs that manage more than $3 billion and invested in hundreds of companies. So we spoke about Yuzma, and the other thing that happened during the early 90s is that Israel, many Russian Jews escaped from Russia and left Russia and came to Israel. We had 1 million immigrants in a small country of then, I think it was 5 million residents or people. And the government said, okay, how do we absorb this amount of people when most of these Russian immigrants were, or many of them were scientists, were very educated and capable people. No entrepreneurial spirit, they were communists, they came from a communist background, but a lot of knowledge. So how do we, on the one hand, give them employment opportunities in their own field, and on the other hand, do something with their know-how and abilities? So the government opened 24 incubators. Today, an incubator, you've heard about it, it's all over. Then it was quite a new thing. It opened 24 incubators all over Israel. Each incubator invested in 10 projects that the Office of the Chief Scientist sponsored. So basically, the Office of the Chief Scientist granted each project $300,000 for 2 years. After two years, they had to have a proof of concept and to go to the first round of investments. This created hundreds of projects and also gave employment to a lot of people, and this also created the managerial skills and the entrepreneurial skills of these Russian, mainly Russian scientists. Afterwards, it wasn't only Russians, it was... So what is the Office of the Chief Scientist? This is today all the programs that the Office of the Chief Scientist has. On a national level, we have the generic R&D. This is the main R&D fund, the $300 million. We have two programs that are related to academy, to transferring knowledge from the academy to the industry. These are two small programs. We have pre-seed programs, which are for individual entrepreneurs and the technological incubator. So it's the first 2 years of the companies. You have your applied academic basic research. And we have, I'm sorry, this is the competitive R&D fund. And here we have other programs that support the industry. Now on the international level, this is where most of the activity took place in the recent years. Israel joined the European R&D program. It is, I think, each year pays 60 million euros to participate in this program, and Israeli companies and academia probably win at least 60 million, if not more, from the fund itself. This also creates an opportunity for Israeli companies to work with European companies and basically get more familiar with those companies and work together on R&D. And we have numerous binational funds, R&D funds, like the Bird Agreement, but also with other states. So these are the funds that we have. We have with Singapore, with Canada, with Korea. We have mutual agreements with all these countries and states. And we have also a program with large corporates where we basically come to the Coca-Cola company and tell them, okay, look, you can source our technologies in Israel, you can do joint R&D with Israeli companies. They sign an agreement with the Office of the Chief Scientist that basically tells them, you source out 10 companies, we will fund the R&D. And so this is the collaboration with multinationals, and there is 25 strategic agreements and 75 projects. This one you know, it's basically all the Israel is a source of R&D activity, so it's Israeli companies that became multinational companies, as well as multinational companies that came to Israel to open R&D facilities. So what we want to say is that basically the Office of the Chief Scientist is very in line with the spirit of the country and the startup nation. So the Israeli economic ecosystem, which is unique entrepreneurial spirit, very dynamic, technological development driven by strategic and political constraints, very globalized, because from day one an Israeli company usually registers in the US and not registered as an Israeli company because the market is not local. The office of the chief scientist basically adapts to that and creates on a very flexible and ongoing process programs that can adapt to the globalization and to the needs of the Israeli companies. And this is, I think, my last slide, because basically it, to sum it up, it says that the government here is very tuned to the needs of the industry, and because the high-tech industry is such a vital component of the economy, it basically creates every tool it can and to assist the growth of this industry. So I hope I gave you a good overview of the government.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. And fortunately, we do have time for some questions. It was a very good overview, in the background. So we talked about the Office of the Chief Scientist, BIRD, YOSMA, and the incubator programs. And again, you saw how, in the early 1990s, the exports of tech equal the exports of Jaffa oranges, and that huge difference. And that doesn't happen on its own. We talk about an ecosystem, but also, how important the role of the government is. I'm going to open up for everyone to take a question, but I'll just take my privilege to ask the first question. It was very lively, and we could see the success, and as you said, like programs that ended on time. But looking forward, because I'm sure a lot of your research and your work is not just looking backward but forward, but what does the government see as some of the big challenges? And I'd ask, both from, with the collapse of stock markets and, beyond the dot-com bubble, but general investing, 2008 financial crisis, there's not as much money there. There's all kinds of political things, going on with the Arab Spring around. There's all kinds of global other issues. So what do you see as some of the current real challenges to Israel maintaining that, startup nation drive, and what might the government do to try to mitigate some of those threats?
There are many things that are beyond my capabilities even to explain, and the region is so complicated that I won't even try to start and figure out. But what I must say about the Israeli economy is that throughout the years, and even in very difficult global and local and regional situation, the economy did quite well. At least I think since 85, basically, economy did quite well. And although we are very, because Israel doesn't have a local market, such a big local market, we're very influenced by the global economy. Still, I think that relatively, the economy did well. Now, talking about the challenges of the high-tech sector, there are lots. And I don't think that the global financial crisis is definitely something temporary, hopefully temporary, that has an effect, because less VCs are able to raise money in the US. But I think that there is money in the US. It's just waiting for the right companies or to invest in. So there is money sitting there, and there isn't lack of money. I think that opportunities will come, and it will be like a cycle that will come to life again. But I think that the main challenge is, first of all, the manpower in Israel. So Israel is a small country, and we have, if you compare to India or China, we have the numbers of engineers in Israel is really peanuts. So what do we rely on? The quality of the engineers, the entrepreneurial spirit of the engineers, their ingenuity. But this is something that more and more countries will adapt to and will probably create. And so this is a challenge. How do you stay entrepreneurial, innovative, and competitive when you are in such small numbers? So, and the government here is not only the Office of the Chief Scientist, because the Office of the Chief Scientist gives money to companies, but it's also the Ministry of Education and all the, basically, everything around it. The government is looking to enhance the number of students that learn science, for example. They want to see if we need to go into specific sectors, for example. We are now, all our grants and all the activity that we do, we don't prefer a sector, one sector to the other. I think the only preference we gave is in biotechnology, because biotechnology has very specific needs. It's a long run, it's a long-term process and things like that. But besides biotechnology, we don't give any preference to a specific sector. This is something that we are discussing. Should we? Should we be strong in specific sectors and not try to cover everything? Today we are responding to the demand of the companies. This is something that is, there are lots of thoughts that behind that. So.
Yeah, let me, I won't take another question, but a follow-up. I think it's a great observation. The people, the talent, so there was 1 million, you know, Russian immigrants, and you're not getting that. But with the schools, Mayor Bloomberg is trying to figure out how to keep our economy going. Mm-hmm. One thing they're doing is they figure we need applied scientists in New York. We have some great universities, but not the technical schools and applied science schools, so they're inviting bids. And one of the most promising is Cornell partnering with Technion. Technion is the MIT and Stanford of Israel. 80% of the successful startups we read about, 80% had graduates of Technion. Mm-hmm. So if I could just for a follow-up question, what is the role specifically with encouraging and working with those universities and academia?
So if I'll just briefly go back, I don't want to make you too tired. So the government is putting a lot of emphasis on how do we take the creative and the know-how from universities to the industry, basically. And what we are doing as the Ministry of Industry and Trade, we are providing a lot of grants to researchers to examine their ideas together with the industry. So if, for example, a researcher goes to one of the Israeli companies, he can tell them the government will finance 80 or 90% of the project. You need to put just 10%. But this 10% makes the industry very involved in the project and makes them, you know, they care about it. And they work together with the scientist or the academic researcher. And this creates a pipeline of companies. The other thing is we work very strongly with each university in Israel, and I think also anywhere around the world, but has the commercial arm of the university that basically, and putting strong people over there that know IP and know how to identify interesting and new technologies, they work together with the universities and they try to source out the interesting technologies and encourage the researchers to make more applied science and not just basic science. And the researcher always gets also, of course, options and equity in companies, and this is probably the best incentive ever to his colleagues to do also, to go into applied academic research. There is also a program which is available, it's also here, it's not an Israeli invention, the consortia of companies and academic research, where they group together and research on very basic platform technologies. And over here, academy has to be part of the program. So this, in these ways, we always encourage the interface between the industry and the academy. This is, and usually academy gets 100% funding in these projects. So, you know, because it's hard for them to get the money from the outside. So usually it's 100% funding for the academies.
The academy means far from like
universities and,
We just invite our two professors who visited if they'd like to ask a question, then we'll open it up.
I had a question, not about innovation on that, as most of the programs that you mentioned seemed like the government put in money, but it wasn't getting the upside. And so presumably the idea is that the country will get something out of it. It seems, and I'd like to know what that is, just the two things, the two aspects that seem to be, have come to the forefront in recent months maybe, is that this employment doesn't seem to, there seems to be unemployment in many sectors, of the regional sector, and also there seems to be increasing inequality. So, I mean, this is great, but has that translated into something good for the entire country, and how?
So yes, the government doesn't get the upside except for royalties, but it doesn't get the upside from the companies, from the value of the companies, and but it gets a lot of upside from other social upside and spillover, what we say. So if even if a company fails, we view it as a success. Not can be better, but it's not a failure from our perspective. Even if a company goes to the office of its chief scientist and said, okay, didn't work out, product is no good, we can't find another investor, even then the government will probably sponsor them again. Why? Because there is a lot of knowledge created. One company is closed, 10 startup then are initiated out of the same company. ECI, for example, had, you know, from one huge company, there were hundreds of startup companies created from one company. So there is a spillover effect, and this is what the government gains. The other thing that the government gains is employment. And creating new knowledge and serial entrepreneurship and broadening this knowledge also to other populations. Now, this is a problem in Israel. There are some populations, mainly the ultra-Orthodox and the Arabs in Israel, are poor populations, and there is a lot of effort today from the government side. It's not enough to integrate these populations into, not into society, but mainly into narrowing the gap. Now, how do we narrow, how we try to narrow the gap? For example, now we try to initiate in the ultra-Orthodox, probably you know, in Israel, the men usually don't work and the women work. And with lots of capabilities, have great learning abilities. So we are now promoting the service industry in Israel, trying to promote, it's like, all sanctuaries of ultra-Orthodox Jewish women that give software services to companies in Israel and all over the world. So they sit near their house and they are in a strictly religious environment, and so they are comfortable and they don't feel that they compromise with their religion, and they develop software, they program software, they develop all kinds of software services to companies. This is a project that is being supported heavily by the government, and quite successful project. So this is one way. The Arab population, we try to build technological incubators in the Arab population. We supported a VC, we put tender for VCs that will invest only in companies that were generated or were generated by Israeli Arabs, and this is something that also the government supports. If it's enough, no, it's not enough. but definitely the way to narrow the gaps between the poor populations in Israel and the very successful guys that you saw here before is attracting them and pulling them into this high-tech scene, where salaries are high, where there is an upside, and they can then, you know, creates more. They are part of the society. So this is the way. We have a long way to go.
Quick follow-up. I think actually more of the other traditional part of the population is thinking of the social unrest this summer, the tent cities and all that. Most of those people, I don't think, were ultra-Orthodox or Arab. Right, so but that seems to be a feeling among the non-Arab, non-ultra-Orthodox part of the population that there's stagnation in standard of living, maybe you know uncertainty regarding employment.
I'm not sure about unemployment. I think that the middle class in Israel basically is feeling very stressed. So there is a standard of living is, or cost of living is high, and one of the most beautiful things that happened in Israel recently, you know, Israeli population became very, they weren't so involved in what's going on. They said, okay, these are the taxes, this is the cost of living, and this is how we live, and okay, we couldn't. Didn't care so much, and what happened, which is similar and not similar to what to Occupy Wall Street, is the social movement in Israel, which was probably an amazing phenomena from my perspective because we hadn't seen it for such a long time, and creating a social, a very broad social movement that said, okay, enough, we want to. We want the government, and we want to change a little bit the system, that it would be more social and more caring for weak populations and more equal, basically. And the government has put a very prominent economist named Manuel Trachtenberg, that his main, I think his, basically his, I don't know if he did his PhD on innovation and the spillover effect of R&D and innovation, he sat down and viewed and talked to the population and to the government and to every and to the industry and everyone, and put together a plan on trying to narrow the gap. If it will be enough, I don't know. If the government will implement it, I hope that it will implement some of it. And some of it is already implemented. You know, not everybody will be happy, and if everybody is happy, then probably the state will be in a very good shape. But I hope that things will change also for the better for the middle class, middle-lower class in Israel. But it's true, there was this high-tech boom created a very high net worth community that mainly wanted, exits. You know, they had an idea, 5 years, sold it to AOL, $65 million. Today you have Apple is going to buy an Israeli company for $400 million.
Since the 1990s,
every day
Israel
you have,
has been at the forefront of global high-tech industry.
Every day that you have a story like that, and the 10 more people are becoming very, very wealthy. What's happening to the rest of the population?
Well, the technological phenomena, because the currency is all over the world.
This is
your secret sauce.
I set that up to play for the class after. That's a great video.
Yeah.
I guess he just started playing.
So, thank you very much for having me, unless you have any other,
I just wanted to go back a little bit, a few more decades. Most of your presentation concentrates from the mid-90s, but
yes,
we know that also in the 50s there were high-tech companies like Teva, El Sint that started, and low-tech products like Israeli couscous that started as a response to the Arab boycott. How was the environment back then?
Cool. In the 50s in Israel, the environment was very bad. It was
Since the 1990s,
years
in
Israel
were at the forefront of global high-tech industry.
If I'm not mistaken, we all the food was gave in quotas in Israel in the 1950s. So it was a very, from an economic perspective, it was a very hard times. Teva just started, as you know, it was a small pharmacy that just started with things, and there weren't really big companies. Exports was very low. Economic situation wasn't that good. I think that there were some good decades, some better decades, worse decades. I think that probably I concentrated on later years because this is where the government was most prominent. I'm not talking about the inflation years where it's the Ministry of Finance's point of view. I'm talking about how the government influenced and affected the and was had a positive effect on the industry. And maybe one just to make you know, the slide with the oranges and the IT, look at it as agriculture and
technology.
and software, but it's basically, if we're talking about the 50s, the main product that Israel exported was Jaffa oranges. Today we export quite a lot of food products as well as, but mainly agricultural know-how, agrotechnology capabilities. So it's netafim with the drip irrigation and other seeds companies, very sophisticated in Israel, but it's all from know-how and less from manufacturing. Manufacturing in Israel basically is more with companies like Iskar, the one with, that was the Warren Buffett one, bought, which is mainly sophisticated manufacturing, where you need also the R&D people and the engineers to work with the manufacturing facilities. Although, you know, I generalize, there are some very low to mid-tech companies like Keter Plastic, for example. I assume that most of the plastic chairs you're using are produced in Carmel in Israel. Very successful plastic company that created toolboxes and chairs and all kinds of things. It's low mid-tech. But now, where do they invest? In innovation, in new products, new ideas, new materials, new solutions. So everything is being pushed to the more sophisticated manufacturing than just...
Whatever happened to that shaver that was invented in a kibbutz?
The legs?
Yes.
For the leg?
Yeah.
Epilady.
Yeah, whatever happened.
Yeah, it was a huge success. So the first hair remover was invented in a kibbutz in northern Israel. It was called Epilady. But a year, I think, after it was in the market, China copied it and they crashed. So it's...
We have time for maybe two more questions. I don't want to keep you had a
question? I was thinking about staying power. I hear a lot about innovation and startup, and then the innovators sell the company, and where do they go? I mean, this gentleman is working the American company, but what about keeping it in Israel and growing and having a company that's 50, 60 years, I mean, hoping to staying power?
So this is a very philosophical debate in Israel. So Yossi Vardi, for example, the one that you've seen in the video, says, we are fine with startup companies. This is what we are best at. This is what we know how to do. And we can create companies and sell them. And selling the companies doesn't mean that necessarily Israel loses. So now we have a senior VP in AOL, which will be very open to other Israeli startup companies, which is affiliated with Israel, which still employs 160. I don't know how many people he employs in Israel. He doubled the company because now he has a very strong backing. Most of his R&D is done in Israel. So this is one point of view. The other, and there are many that say exactly like you say, so where is the benefit? Why can't we, so the companies are, there are two problems. First problem is that the companies are sold too fast. Too fast, because if he'll wait another year, he wouldn't receive only 65, maybe he would but he's young, he wants to make money. So this is one thing, so you sell them too cheap. The other thing is, how can you keep the value in Israel? So I heard a very interesting lecture by Jeff Immelt, the CEO of GE. And he said that he was previously the head of the healthcare, GE healthcare. And he came very often to Israel because Israel had very good imaging technologies. And he said, you know, you had the best technologies in the world, but you didn't know how to sell it. So is it worth anything? We had technologies, probably not the best, but we had technologies. Mm-hmm. We had the best sales force ever. And this was the match. They bought Israeli companies for 160 million. Mm-hmm. They're selling now the products for 2 billion. Mm-hmm. What does Israel get out of it? It gets out of it the relationship with GE. Mm-hmm. GE is constantly looking at Israel as a source of innovation. Mm-hmm. They know better how to negotiate, probably. Mm-hmm. How to get, and R&D is still in Israel. So the high paying jobs are still in Israel, constantly developing more products. It's a global world that some of the people will come here. You know what? It's also good. They learn the culture. They learn how to be better salespeople. They learn how to negotiate better. They learn how to work in a global environment. And they'll come back to Israel sometime, or if not, they'll work with Israelis and teach them. So you can't fight that. That's the, yeah. But it is an issue that is being debated a lot in Israel.